This weekend is a celebration of Larkin's youth and connection with this area in Bourne. So I think it's delighted to see you all here this evening. Looking forward to an evening of music and crack and storytelling. First of all, could I just make you aware of those that are strangers to the area, fire exits, which are to the left at the bottom here and at the back to the left. So hopefully we're not believing that, but anyway. So to move on, before I introduce the first artist of this evening, I'd like to give you a little brief history of this venue for those who have travelled, because it is interesting. Bourne Hall was opened in 1912. Interestingly, the same year as Big James Larkin helped form the Irish Labour Party in Dublin. Unusually for those times, and indeed now, the hall was constructed without the input or influence of any organisation, whether that be church, state, local government, or even sporting body. It was built simply by the people, for the people of this area. That great sense of independence has continued right down until this day. This hall is used vastly in the community by many groups, which run from the Busy Bees for the preschool age right through to even the karate club. One organisation, the Bourne Dramatic Society, has been in existence in this area for as long, certainly, as I remember, and even the older members in the audience will remember it as well. My grandfather and all used to talk about the fantastic plays that was held in Bourne Dramatic Hall, and they were known far and wide, and they still are. The Dramatic Society helps through their productions to promote this hall, and indeed the proceeds of all the events are ploughed back into the facilities here for the young people and indeed the old people of Bourne. Our main artist this evening is Tommy Sands, a man who is no stranger to Bourne, as just like Jim Larkin, he spent much of his youth with his aunts Sally and Maggie and uncles Pat and James on his mother Brady Connolly's side here in Bourne. Having commenced a singing career under the udder of a cow, he moved from one group, as those who are engaged in farming activities will know what a group is. I hope I don't need to explain any more. Tommy joined another group with his brothers and sisters and formed the illustrious Sands Family Group, which toured successfully throughout Ireland and Europe, bringing Irish folk music to a new audience and putting this area of Newry and Mourne on the world map. Tommy eventually broke into broadcasting, and as you know, hosts Country Cayley on Downtown Radio on Saturday evenings. He is awarded a doctorate in the USA for his work with the prison community. Tommy is also a driving force behind the Fiddler's Green Festival in Restrever. He has also written his own book, Songman, which is available here tonight. An interesting little aside, again for strangers of the area, in fact maybe for those that are not as far away from home, is that I could explain to you that right in the middle of Hall, back in the late 60s or 70s, I think it was probably from about row 4 to row 14, the hall was extended. This extension covered that little plot of ground that I'm talking about, which is right in the middle of the hall. This land was owned by Tommy's aunt and uncle, the Connollys, but was never legally transferred into Bourne Hall trustees until sometime 25 years later, a keen-eyed legal from either the Point O'Meara Bridge and the Connolly occupation, once and for all. But that's one little story, an anecdotal story of the evening, and I'm sure you'll hear many, many more from our main guest this evening, ladies and gentlemen, Tommy Sands.
Thank you very much, Declan. See, there's a good religious audience in tonight. You come in early to get a good seat at the back. Let the circle be wide round the fireside, and we'll soon make room for you. Let your heart have no fear, for there's no strangers here, just friends that you never knew. Shake the hand of the man from the far distant land, meet and treat him well, and that young girl so fair is sitting over there. She's got a story to tell, don't we all? So let the circle be wide round the fireside, and we'll soon make room for you. Let your heart have no fear, for there's no strangers here, just friends that you never knew. We will travel along on the wings of a song, with a mind that is open and free. If we close our eyes to the other side, we're just half of what we could be. So let the circle be wide round the fireside, and we'll soon make room for you. Let your heart have no fear, for there's no strangers here, just friends that you never knew. This burn means an awful lot to me. My mother came from here, as Declan said, and sometimes at home when we were very young, maybe under the blankets, with her, she used to mark out the road to Burn on the threads of the blanket or the sheet. She used to say, you go up the end of the lane, up the lane road, past Beverly Wilson's, Nora Wilson's, Joey Sands's, Claire Sands's, Scott's, Ned Callahan's, Eddie Cunningham's, Rosie Murphy, Pat Garvey, Paddy Gallagher, across the big road. Sometimes we go up the Aidan Moore Road up past Goss's. Sometimes we go up the Achnagun Road up past John Quinn, Lily Quinn, Jerry Quinn. He fell off to school and broke his leg one day. He got the 11 plus almost immediately afterwards. The only one ever to get the 11 plus at the Bridge School in those days. And he's here tonight. Then she says, you go way on up, round that bad corner. But Lachlan's Corner, I think she called it. On up the road, you see Thomas Trainers. It's a shop. And on down the Carrick Road, and if you look away across, you can see Auntie Sally's and Uncle James's, and Frank McClory's and Malam's. Then you come on down, you pass Arthur King's, Alice and Mac. I never knew their second name. And then you come to Fagan's, Rose Fagan, Jimmy Fagan, the most beautiful garden I've ever seen in my life. Up past Carrick School, where she went to school. And then there was Susan Connolly and Maggie Connolly. Then up to the pond, past McMahon's shop, Mary and Bridget, Parents. And there's a near cut. You could cut across that wee elbow there and round to Auntie Maggie's, and Uncle Patrick's and Uncle Peter's. And there were great times there. And in the book that I'll read you a few pages from after a while, talk a little bit about that. So let the circle be wide round the fireside, and we'll soon make room for you. Let your heart have no fear, for there's no strangers here, just friends that you never knew. So we'll pass a bottle round, and we'll drink another round, that our friendship will always remain. For how can you tell, when we say our farewells, when will we all meet again? So let the circle be wide, round the fireside, and we'll soon make room for you. Let your heart have no fear, for there's no strangers here, just friends that you never knew. Whoo! Thank you very much indeed. I'm delighted to be here. I'm delighted to see so many great friends in the audience, and neighbours, and relations, very close. I suppose it's a great event here. Coming to this historic occasion, Jim Larkin, the event celebrating the life and times of Big Jim Larkin, I'd like to sing a song about a man that Larkin, his funeral oration Jim Larkin gave, you can put it that way, a man called Joe Hill. Joe Hill was an American trade union leader, and he was executed wrongly. Big Jim Larkin went over and gave the funeral oration. I dreamed I saw Joe Hill last night, alive as you and me. Says I, but Joe, you're 10 years dead. I never died, said he. I never died. Santiago up to me, in every mine and mill, where workers strike to gain the rights, it's there you'll find Joe Hill. It's there you'll find Joe Hill. Santiago, Joe, said I, and standing by side, it framed you on a murder charge. Said Joe, I never died. Said Joe, I never died. I dreamed I saw Joe Hill last night, alive as you and me. Said I, but Joe, you're 10 years dead. I never died, said he. I never died, said he. And Jim Larkin is not dead either. And I suppose his philosophy is very useful at the present time when ordinary working people are fighting and killing each other. But I suppose before I introduce you to our first guest tonight, I'd just like to sing you all a song. And it's amazing how important humour has been over the past number of years living here. In fact, humour is a very serious thing. It's almost sacramental. It takes you into another place, into another land. And this is a song which I wrote after hearing yarns, different stories and yarns here and there. And in fact, I remember overhearing two poets talking one night. One says to the other, what are you doing at the minute? What do you think I'm doing? I'm writing a poem. How are you getting on? I'm stuck. You're stuck. How are you stuck? I can't think of a word to rhyme with great. Oh man, says, I shouldn't be too hard now. Let me see. Great, great. Says, how about fascinate? Great, fascinate. Brilliant, says your man, and he starts to write. He says, I'm finished. Do you want to hear to do? I have a lovely duffel coat. I really think it's great. There are 9 buttons on it, but I can only. The worst ever I heard. But the thing is, whenever you're writing songs, sometimes you're trying to think of words to go with meanings, and other times you're trying to think of meanings to go with words. But I say this is a song which I cobbled together. It's not a real song at all. It's only made up, as many of them are. It's made up from different yarns and stories that I heard. And there's a part in it, actually, where you can clap your hands twice at a certain moment. And there's no point in me telling an intelligent audience like yourselves when or where you clap your hands. You'll know. But it's in the chorus. That's the only clue I'll give you. Knock on your door and the road, and I'll go. Up with your glasses and rise in your bone, the road. your pockets for this, by the way. By the way, where was part of the hat that we in, Patsy Quinn? In a doss house in Dublin, the landlady said, you can stay more than night if you make your own bed. No trouble, says I have done that before. But she says there's a hammer and nails on the floor. In a restaurant fine, says I, would you give me a bottle of wine? What year would you like? The landlord did say, says I, my good man, I would like it today. It's a little bit like a bit of Shakespeare, or a lump out of the Bible, God says. But I remember hearing a story of this folk singer who was traveling around the countryside, and he wasn't looking after himself very well. Maybe he was sitting up too late at night, or maybe drinking the wrong type of food. But whatever happened to him anyway, he got what they call laryngitis, and he couldn't talk, never mind sing. But he saw a sign for a doctor's surgery beside the theatre where he's playing. And he sort of said something like, Dr. Adams Appleby, we fix throats, something like that. But he knocked on the door, and the doctor's very attractive female assistant came to the door. The poor man couldn't talk. He says, is the doctor in? And she said, no, come on in. And fireside bright, and here's to all of us daily with Dickinson playing. From the road I'll go, up with your glasses and rosin your bow. And the road I'll go, and never give up when you're feeling low. You think you can manage that chorus? It's not too high. Give it a try. Great singing and excellent percussion. We'll be returning for more assistance from you as the night goes on. But I'd like to introduce you to a beautiful young woman from Derrynlechy. And she is a harp player, a wonderful harp player. In fact, she's just returned from Lorient, from the Lorient Festival in France, which is a very big festival. And where all the Celtic nations of the world gather every year. And indeed, I remember playing there many years ago. In fact, we took our parents over there to the Lorient Festival in 1975. And I'll never forget it because my mother and father came, and our cousin called Petesy in the Hill and his wife Eileen. And I remember before we left, I think it was Father Hugh Sands, our uncle, was in the house. And my mother says, "Do you think, will we get Mass over there? Will it be, are the Catholics?" And Father Hugh said, "Yes, but French Catholics." And we were playing on this big hill. It was an open-air festival in a place called Cassel. And we're playing a song called Trois Corbies, which is an old Reavers song from the, around the 13th, 14th century. But I had my eyes closed singing the song. And I noticed, when I opened my eyes again, there seemed to be a change in the hill where there's a lot of men and women. And this is in the 70s. And I discovered that they had, in the sun, they'd taken their clothes off, all their clothes off. And my mother looked up as if to say, "Is this the sort of place I see we're going to?" But Petesy in the Hill took a glass of wine. It was the first glass of wine ever he took, and he says, "This is a great place altogether." But anyway, it was in Lorient that Kathleen Keenan spent a couple of weeks. I'm not too sure what she was doing, but I know that she was taking master classes in the harp. And she's representing Ireland on the harp. And we're delighted to have her here in Byrne Hall tonight. Please welcome Kathleen Keenan.
Two digs. The first one was composed by Liz Carroll. I don't have a name for it. And the second one is called The Rolling Wave. I got both these digs off a harp player from Monaghan, Fionnuala Rooney. Thank you. My heart was very hard to keep in tune. Like, it was too cold to go flat, and then if it gets hot, it could go sharp. I was going.
Lackey, wonderful musician as you heard there, and certainly she made her mark in France in Lorient. Well, I'm going to read a little bit from this book, I started writing this book on a train going from going backwards in the train from Vermont to Washington D.C. And the train wasn't going backwards. I was going backwards. I was sitting backwards. And normally I prefer to go the other way, but I couldn't find a seat the other way. But I was going backwards, and I felt almost that I was burrowing into my past in a way. And all these things were flying past me. All the great times and the sad times and the good times. And I'll read you a few little pieces. I won't detain you long, as Henry VIII used to say to the wife. And actually, in a way, that the story begins in Bern. And in around the time, I think it was the day I was born, I remember it well. It's called Between Sleeping and Waking. The golden eye of God peeked over Sleep Donard, and slowly, in its own good time, lit the small farms and fields of South Down in light green, soft yellow, bright orange, dark brown, and a deep, mysterious, transparent grey. The sun didn't rise too early in December, nor indeed did anyone else for that matter in that particular part of the country. Auntie Maggie got up earlier than most. She had visitors. She opened the curtains and eyed the Irish Weekly the bread man Jimmy McGowan had brought. It was lying stretched out and bedraggled on the sofa. She looked at the picture of the man standing on his head on the front page. It was Benito Mussolini, hanging upside down in Italy. She turned it around to see how he looked standing up. He reminded her of old Dr. Taylor. With a shiver, she separated the front and back pages from the rest of the paper, folded them twice, and began to twist them into a rope like she was wringing out one of her brother's shirts. Then she worked the paper ringlet into a circle and set it down upon the cold grey ashes in the hearth. She noted how the ring of newspaper began to slowly unravel into a horseshoe when she let it go, and the man's face seemed to slacken into a strange smile. She smiled back sourly. Auntie Maggie didn't read. There was never anything in newspapers she needed to know. But that face reignited the spark of forgotten apprehension inside her. There was a photograph of a new group of people there who were going to stop wars as well. They were called the United Nations. She thought they looked like the Bern Gaelic Athletic Association. The GAA was set up in 1884 to promote Irish sport and to stop faction fights between parishes. In the front row sat a man, arms folded, the spit of her brother James. James was chairman of the local committee. She smiled a different smile and began twisting the pages again. When all the paper was in the hearth, she placed small twigs on top and then larger ones and took a flame from the sacred heart lamp hanging on the wall behind her head and set them alight. It was the first smoke to curl up a burned chimney on the morning of the 19th of December, 1945. Then Auntie Maggie let out the hands. Come on out now, the good hands, and I know we are cackled if you let an egg. The two children of her youngest sister, Bridie, were at her heels. They loved boiled eggs. After breakfast, Auntie Maggie made a startling announcement. You'll have a wee brother before the night, she whispered. How do you know that, they asked in wonder. It's as clear as day in those tail ends, she said. And his name would be Thomas. No one ever doubted Auntie Maggie. She had a way of knowing things long before they happened. She would even predict the day and date of her own death, but that would be many years later. Now was the time for celebrating life. The war was over, Hitler was dead, Mussolini too, and a lot of other people were dead as well. But the darkest nights would soon be gone. Christmas and New Year were just around the corner, and today a child would be born. It is still too early for Bridie to celebrate. She was the youngest of the Connolly family, youngest of the girls, and the life and soul of every party. She had played camogie with Byrne, enacted in many of the plays. She had inherited her talents on accordion and concertina from her granduncle, Owen Smith, and her love of words from her own father, Owen Connolly, the poet. Now she was waiting to go into the theatre in Rathfarnham Hill Hospital. This would be her third caesarean of seven. The operation was scheduled for 11. She had no way of knowing if it would be a boy or a girl. She only prayed that all would be well. Well, it was, thankfully. Up to now. So now a little bit. So page 41. We grew up, you know, very often when we go abroad and we're asked on television, where do you come from? We really don't come from anywhere. We come from near places. We come from near Mayo Bridge, near Saville, near Burn, near Rathfryland, near Newry. But of course, it was the centre of the earth. And we were, according to post office mistresses, we came from Mayo Bridge. But according to parish priests, we came from Saville. So that's why two of us went to the Mayo Bridge School, two went to Sheep Town, and the other two went in between, to both. But this was a... Let me find this page. Yes. Page 41 in your exercise books. There were no Protestants at Mayo Bridge School, except Harry McGarry. We knew he was different, for he didn't come into the catechism class when the rest of us were learning about who made the world and who God is. God is our Father in heaven, creator and Lord of all things, actually. Instead, Harry kicked a ball about the schoolyard on his own. While we were becoming good Christians, he was becoming a good footballer. Also believed in God, and that he even believed that it was God who made the world. I said I liked football too, actually. And we became good friends. I noticed that he never touched the ball with his hands when he played football. We're not allowed to, he said. Is it a sin, I asked. I suppose so, he said. What a strict religion, I thought. Later that evening, my father explained that it wasn't really football he was playing at all. It was a game called soccer, and it came from England. Our football game was called Gaelic, and it is Irish. Is it a sin for a Catholic to play soccer, I asked my father. Well, if you play for a Gaelic team, then you're not allowed to play for a soccer team, he said. That's rule 32 in the official GAA guide. Would you go to hell if you did, I asked. Not necessarily, he smiled, but you might be told to. He explained all down the years, England wanted Ireland to become English, but by playing their own games and singing their own songs, the people here were saying, we're Irish. England didn't want Protestant people here playing Irish games either, in case they would become Irish, for then Ireland would not become English after all. It all sounded very complicated to me, but I passed it on to Harry as best as I could, and we played a mixture of Gaelic and soccer in the schoolyard. The next day, Harry told me that his da had told him to tell me to tell my da that even if good Protestant policemen wanted to play Gaelic, which they didn't anyway, but even if they did, the narrow Gaelic rules would not allow it, and to put that in his pipe and smoke. That night, my father told me to tell Harry to tell his dad that the rule only came about because the police force had made an earlier rule banning their own policemen from playing Gaelic games, and to put that in his pipe and his pipe. I don't think either of them either smoked pipes, but I knew they liked whiskey, and I wondered why they didn't tell each other all those complicated things while they were drinking together in Hale's pub in Uri on a Saturday night. Still, some of the messages rubbed off on the messengers, and we learned a lot, Harry and me, in that playground of knowledge at the Bridge of Meath. I imagine Davy McGarry sent his son to a Catholic school because he felt 2.5 miles was long enough for a child to walk in a winter's morning. The state school, geared for Protestants and rarely attended by Catholics, was almost 5 miles away. Sometimes Harry and I wondered why Catholics and Protestants didn't go to the same school in the first place. Tell young Sands to tell his dad. The Catholics won't go to state schools because the Church of Rome wants to keep control of them. And while he's at it, would he ask him if he would lend me the loan of the stirrup pump for a few days whitewashing? Tell young McGarry to tell Big Davy that for years England made it illegal for Catholics to receive any education at all, and haunted and hanged their teachers and holy priests during the penal days. And was it any wonder Catholics built their own schools? And what the hell stirrup pump is he talking about? Tell that wee skitter's get to tell his old Fenian dad that the penal days were years ago, and there are now lovely schools and dinners and warm fires in every room for everybody to learn in, and there would be one in Mayo Bridge too, but the Catholics wouldn't go to it, and the stirrup pump is the one he said was great for whitewashing with last Saturday night in the Hale's pub. Tell that black-mouthed son of a Presbyterian orange man that they can stick their soup in their pot-bellied stoves in their state schools so the monkey stuck the bananas. Those schools tell only an English view of Irish history, and well, he knows it. And that I can't lend him a stirrup pump because I lent it to him last summer and he never gave it back. But if I had it, he would get it, for he's a decent man. And if he isn't doing anything next Monday, could he give me a day to thresh him? And so it went on until the seemingly insoluble conflicts would be shelved for the time being. For friendships were just as deep as differences, and life went on from sowing to mowing, and from mowing to thrashing. I'll just read you an old little bit here, and it's about football. And I remember coming up here years ago, my Uncle James used to be writing out the names of all the players on the Burn team in Irish. And remember the Burn team that time? Kevin Fagan was playing. Glad to see Kevin here tonight. Frank McClory. John McClory was just finished playing. But football is very, very important. But it caused a serious international diplomatic row in this next chapter. Better take a drink before that. My father was not by any stretch of the imagination a violent man. With one rare lapse, however, in 1960, he managed to cut off all relations between our house and the rest of the world. Admittedly, when he was younger, he pulled a pushy politician from a podium outside the Bridge Chapel one Sunday morning. And then there was that Saturday night, he put some big man out through Hale's window. But such behaviour was very uncharacteristic. I remember once when Roy started in a pub, he whispered to me that he was feeling a bit frightened. Not of anyone in the pub, mind you, but of this fellow here, he said, pointing at himself. He had a bit of a temper, but he very seldom let it out. Someone invited him to fight at the Fryland Fair one time, but he said he'd rather sing a song instead, which drove the other man mad entirely. Eventually, they agreed to a wrestling match, and my father won and then sung the song. In August 1960, the year of our Lord, he coolly picked up the biggest knife in the kitchen and stabbed our old wet battery wireless in the speaker. He followed this up by throwing a cup of tea in its face, soaking such far-flung stations as Stockholm, Oslo, Frankfurt and London with hot, wet tea leaves. His general target on that occasion was Athlone, the headquarters of Ireland's national radio station, and Micheál O'Hare, the brilliant sports commentator in particular. Take that, you carny. What the name of God are you at, Mick? Said my mother, who was only half listening to the match and half doing the Irish Weekly crossword. And that, you knob-faced nur, he shouted, delivering a bare-knuckled blow to its hitherto smiling dial. It is all because of a Gaelic football match. Down were trailing by 2 points against Offaly. It had been a bruising All-Ireland Senior Championship semi-final. There was just a few minutes left in the game, and James McCartan, the dynamic Down centre half-forward, had been donned in the square. Paddy Doherty was getting ready to take the penalty kick. All around Croke Park, you could cut the tension with a knife. Around our table, things were no less fraught, and a bread knife that usually cut simple, sooty fowls for quiet country people was lying relaxed and innocent nearby. O'Hare was almost hoarse with excitement. Paddy Doherty now standing by to take the penalty, his socks down around his ankles. The crowd are hushed. At that moment, the whole population of County Down, it seemed, was either in Croke Park or gathered around a wireless like ours, teething prayers and threats alike to saints and other holy people who might have influence and providence in such times. Can Doherty score this and save the day for Down and put them into their first ever All-Ireland final in history? O'Hare went on breathlessly. He's placing the ball on the 14-yard line. This could be the most important kick of his life, the most important kick in the life of the County Down. He's stepping back now. The crowd are holding their breath. Here he comes. O'Hare lowered his voice to a whisper. He puts his head down to one side in a familiar style. A hush has fallen over the crowd. Here he comes. There was deathly silence. He stopped breathing, waiting for the kick. He waited and waited and waited. But Paddy Doherty never got the ball kicked in our house. Our wireless had stopped breathing. The wet battery had run out. It needed to be charged again, but not in the manner that it had been charged by my father. Bad scrunty for a dirty, rotten, treacherous, two-faced son of a bitch's ghost of an excuse for a wireless reward, with lefts and rights to AFN Frankfurt and the BBC Home Service. If you were playing that pop rubbish in Luxembourg, you wouldn't break down a highway. Perhaps we had the volume turned up too loud. Liam Daly told us later that high volume could drain the power out of a battery. Others said that even a wireless could suffer the effects of tension, which in turn could have drained the battery. And then there was the weak signal and clearer and less work for the old wireless, but the BBC never broadcast Gaelic games. As it happened, Paddy Doherty scored that penalty and Donegal qualified for its first ever All-Ireland final. But we wouldn't know that until the next morning when Jack Grant would come round with the Irish press and the groceries in Gormansbury. Well, I'll give you a bit of a rest for the moment. And speaking of All-Irelands, later... We brought that battery up to Mrs. Linden's shop, whose grandson Mickey would later lead Down in the All-Ireland final in the 90s. And I remember watching them training in Cabrony Park in Restrever and running up and down to the big stone, and it seemed that they were sweating for the very hills that they lived in, and such a great sense of place. And I wrote a song which we sang on the Up for the Match programme on RTE. I'll give you a verse of it. And the cheering like thunder rolled, the flags they flew on every pole, and we sang and danced the whole way home on the day we won the All-Ireland. That's the chorus of it. Now, speaking of All-Irelands, there's a young man about to appear on the stage who has won the All-Ireland 3 times on the bar on. He comes from Mayo Bridge. Himself and his sister are part of the Rooney family, a wonderful, wonderful music family. And they're just beginning. They've already played much and done wonderful things, but I know they're just beginning because they'll do great things. In fact, I was speaking to a man during the week, and I'm going to be asking them afterwards about the possibility of some gigs in Denmark. They're just wonderful. Eamon plays the baron, and Eamon's mother, of course, comes from Byrne, one of the McMahons. Josephine McMahon is Linda's mother, who's the mother of Eamon and Sheila. But please give them a very, very special home welcome to Eamon and Sheila Rooney on Barlands.
Thanks very much, folks. This is Eamon and I'm Sheila. Just in case you had any trouble figuring out who is who. We're going to start off with a couple of tunes. The first one's called the famous Barravan. I learnt it whenever we were over in the Isle of Skye and there were workshops, and this is a Gordon Duncan tune, and we were told that he had a caravan that, well, basically him and his friend travelled around in this caravan, and it was that well stocked with numerous beverages that it was referred to the Barravan. Barravan. So that he wrote this tune in honour of the Barravan. I'm going to play a reel for you now. Unfortunately, I don't have a name for it, but it's a cracking tune, so we'll see how we get on. Thank you.
quick change over here. We're going to play something that we first did as a feature of our first gig here in Warren Point, which really set the ball rolling for us all. It's our Boron duet. We started first playing it here in Byrne at a night similar to tonight, but and now it's become a part of our act, and we get requests for it, so hopefully it turns out okay tonight.
Same with the football field. That generosity was always there from the Connolly family. But whenever this event here was starting to hatch in here somewhere, one of the first people they asked was Tommy Sands. They said to Tommy, he's thinking of running the Jim Larkin, the festival or bottom school, would you be free for a night? And he says, Mr. Warren, I'm free. And I don't know where he meant he was free for the night, or free. Kathleen and Sheila and Eamon, a home produced show with a home produced man turning out the show. So I'm delighted to be here. I also want to pay a tribute to a few people. I'm not here to do speeches tonight, but to pay a tribute to a few people who assisted me with the event. We have the Border Community Association here. Eddie Ward is the chairman, Patsy Dunn, John, stage name them for the Community Association, who without them co-hosting this, it just wouldn't have happened. We had Tini on the forum, who endless help to give us, getting adverts together, getting the publication out. We had the sponsor, the main sponsor, and we have our own committee too, that we call ourselves the Larkin Committee. You're down there, you know who you are, so I don't have to name you. But again, we talked earlier about finance. The main finance for the event was provided by Parker Green International. It's an American-based, Irish-based, Malawi-based, all over the world-based, headed up by a Bobby Holden man whose parents were from where? Born. So Jared O'Hara, I don't know if Jared is down yet tonight or not. And whenever I went to Jared and talked it over, he says, Seamus will look after you. And then, and who was Seamus? Seamus McVeigh from Ford. So this is very, very much important event. So without those sponsors, we certainly couldn't have operated. Very grateful for the sponsorship, and the event is due to them mainly. Finally, I must pay tribute to Tommy in the book. I have read it, but I didn't remember reading those parts either, so I can go over. But it's a brilliant book, and it is on sale at the back. But we have a cup of tea for everyone. There's lots of cup of tea at the back. And Tommy will autograph anyone that purchases a book. He will autograph it for them. And as well as that, we're running a raffle for a couple of books. Tickets are quite expensive, so anybody can transmit me also to get a book. But I appreciate yourself coming along tonight to open the show for us. The show didn't open on stage altogether. It opened in the hall and filled up. And I'm delighted you're here, and I hope those of you are staying with us for the weekend. Actually, the first man that came to the door tonight came from Limerick, and the actual people from Dublin, and people from Charlotte. So, we're far from home. Delighted to have you all here tonight. I hope you enjoy the rest of the night and the weekend. Thank you.
Again, you're looking much better in the second half than you were in the first. I don't know what was in that pee. Before we go any further, I'd like to welcome some visitors from overseas here. Two wonderful people all the way from Texas, Robert and Dodie Carter. Give them a big welcome. And also the whole way from Australia, Julie Gibson. Julie. Songs, and we're going to introduce you to another wonderful guest. Then we maybe do another little short reading and introduce you to Kathleen once again, and then we'll finish off with a few songs. But strange the place you find inspiration to write songs. Song after paying a very brief visit to a toilet with a pub attached in Belfast. And I was coming through Belfast one night, and it was overheating slightly, so I decided to go in for a drink to a pub. But I didn't know the pub, and in Belfast it's good to know the pub. You could go to the wrong one. So usually what you do is you go to the bathroom and you read the graffiti. And it gives you a very good idea of the clientele they're in. And you know where you stand, so to speak. But I took a look around. It's a dirty laugh, I've never heard one. I could see nothing written on the walls, except, in fact, there's nothing written on the walls at all. I says, what sort of a place is this? This is some sort of an undercover joint. Because usually in Belfast you get some fairly revealing things written on walls. Things like Paisley for Pope. Or help the police, beat yourself up. I remember seeing written up on a wall one time, it said, be alert, Ulster needs alerts. And someone had written underneath that, no, be aloof, we have enough bloody lurts. Which is probably true when you think about it. And there's all the less politically overt things like, little Bo Peep did it for the insurance. But I Eventually, I did come across a piece of graffiti. It is fairly subtle. It was written in white on a white background. And it said, Humpty Dumpty was pushed. And I like that very much. Because there's so many things that we learned when we go to school. Like Humpty Dumpty falling off a wall. There are a lot of things we learned, but a lot of them weren't true at all. We used to believe that Protestants wouldn't go to heaven. Protestants used to believe that Catholics didn't go there either, of course, so there wasn't going to be too many up there anyway. We used to believe that cowboys were good boys and Indians were bad boys. And then George W. came along. So I come up with a conclusion that Humpty Dumpty probably was pushed. Wrote a song about it. Humpty Dumpty was pushed. Ended for heels all over the wall. Humpty Dumpty was pushed. Nobody knew it at all. All the king's horses and all the king's men gathered around and kicked him again. Then they sent for the press and a couple of friends and knelt on the ground and they chanted Amen. Humpty Dumpty was pushed, headed for heels all over the wall. Humpty Dumpty was pushed, nobody knew it at all. The following morning the headlines were tall, really it was inevitable. Mr. Dumpty was drunk and he fell from the wall, or perhaps a bit cracked and shell-shot and all. Heels all over the wall. Humpty Dumpty was pushed. Nobody knew it at all. They wrote in the papers, they wrote in the news, they wrote it in all of the history books. They wrote it in blood and they nearly got stick, and I swallowed it all and I nearly got sick. They took me to hospital, put me in bed, took off my clothes and examined my head. We poisoned your poison with me, said my system rejected the things I was fed. Humpty Dumpty was pushed, headed for heels all over the wall. Humpty Dumpty was pushed, nobody knew it at all. They took me from there and they called me insane. Walls that were padded, the door was chained. And they took me from there and they put me in jail for a lifetime of life I suffered in shame. I cried every night and I slept every day, waited for someone to take me away. Nothing was right and nothing was wrong until I was forced for to learn this new song. Humpty Dumpty sat on the wall, Humpty Dumpty had a great fall. All the king's horses and all the king's men, you know the rest. Thank you very much. Sometimes it seems that things are turned upside down. I grew up in Ryan, on the Ryan Road, and we had a small farm. My father was a small farmer. But the neighbours were all around us were Catholic and Protestant. There weren't any Muslims. There was a Hindu come around selling scarves one day. But that was the only glimpse we had of another world of religion. But everyone was either Catholic or Protestant. Well, there was one woman we weren't too sure what she was, I must admit. We were a bit worried about her. They called her Hard-Boiled Aggie. She lived way over a bit Cullion somewhere. But I know she had some religion in her, maybe a lapsed atheist or a born again pagan, I don't know. Because any time we used to gather spuds for her, and at the end of the week she used to say, if I don't pay you, the Lord will. It wasn't really what we wanted to hear, if you know what I mean. But there was all sorts of stories told about her. One was both the priest and the minister were trying to get her to go to the church or the chapel or the meeting house. But she wouldn't budge. She didn't want to part with money anywhere. But one of them got fed up and he says, Aggie says, do you realise that Jesus Christ died for you? She says, is he dead? She says, we never get any news around here, is it? But I think her reply may have been tempered in some way by her economics. But anyway, actually the people who lived around home were, as I say, from both sides of the divide, and they would come to our house and would sing songs and tell stories. And this is a song about two of them. And it took me almost 10 years to write a song about the event that happened. Because I felt that when the events in the song, when they happened, people couldn't talk. And sometimes music can take up from the place where people stop talking. Because words on their own can maybe reach the ends of the earth at times, but words on the wings of a song can soar higher and dip deeper to places outside of reason. For adding to the sorrows of this troubled northern land. Lately I've been thinking that it just won't leave my mind to tell you of two friends one time who were both good friends of mine. Alan Bell from Bennett, he lived just across the fields. Great man for the music and the dancing and the reels. O'Malley came from South Armagh, court him at his fair, and we'd often meet on the Ryan Road, and the laughter filled the air. There were roses, roses, there were roses, and the tears of the people and together. Though Alan, he was Protestant, Sean was Catholic born, it never made a difference, but the friendship, it was strong. And sometimes in the evening, when we heard the sound of drums, we said it won't divide us, we will always be the one. For the ground our fathers ploughed in, the soil it is the same, and the places where we say our prayers have just got different names. We talked about the friends who died, and we hoped there'd be no more. It's little then we realized the tragedy in store. There were roses, roses, there were roses, and the tears of the people ran together. On a Sunday morning, when the awful news came round, another killing has been done just outside Newrytown. We knew that Alan had stopped there, we knew he liked the band, but when we heard that he was dead, we just could not understand. We gathered at the graveside on that cold and rainy day, and the minister, he closed his eyes and he prayed for no revenge. And all the ones who knew him from along the Ryan Road, we bowed our heads and we said a prayer for the resting of his soul. Christ, it's young O'Malley that they're taking from the door. Alan was my friend, he cried, he begged them with his fear. But centuries of hatred, of ears that cannot hear. A knife or an eye was all that filled their mind. And another eye for another eye, till everyone is blind.
It's a song speaking about Americans earlier on. This is pretty much he's one of the great Americans, I think, of our time, a man called Pete Seeger. And Pete has, I suppose, influenced the world, not with a gun, but with a banjo under his arm. And I was going to say he's an old man. He's 86 now. But he's one of the youngest people I know. Because he never stops listening and he never stops learning. And if you go on like that, it's very hard to grow old, no matter how hard you try, in other ways. And he's written many great songs that you may be familiar with, songs like Where Have All the Flowers Gone, and If I Had a Hammer, many songs. And he lives in a small log cabin on the high banks of the Hudson River. I suppose, physically modest house, but inspirationally palatial. And any time I go over to the United States, I always go to see him. And we were talking about old songs and thinking about new ones. And we're talking about how sometimes music can help to heal wounds between people. And even the different conflicts in one's own head. And I said to Pete, you know, somebody should write a song about that. Pete says, you write it. So I come back a few months later and I sang him the song I'd written. And he stood up all 6'3.5" of himself and he looked out through the window of the Hudson below and he said, it's good, but it's too short. It needs another verse. I said, you write it. Which he did. And we recorded this song together. And it's on an album, actually. It's in a couple of albums. I don't think it's here tonight. Maybe it is, maybe it's not. But it's in one we did about... called Sarajevo, Belfast. And Joan Baez came over to Restrepo to record with us as well. And Joan came over with her mother, who's also called Joan Baez. And she's a beautiful woman. We finished the recording and young Joan, who's 60 now actually, young Joan wanted to go for a run up in the hills behind the house in Restrepo, up in the old oak forest. And old Joan says, I won't go today, I won't run today. I'm going to lie down here and take a snooze. But my son, Fanon, came back home from school, and there's no one in the house. Catherine was away at the time. And he came in, and there's no one in the house except this elderly lady he'd never seen before in his life. And she opened one eye, and she says, hi, kid, I'm Joan Baez. And Fionnuala had heard our records, but he'd never seen her. Didn't know what to say. He says, "You've got a great voice for your age." And she says, "I don't have a voice, kid, but God gave me a beautiful angel for a daughter, and she's running in those hills with your father." The song's called The Music of Healing. Children, don't sing the songs about the winning and losing. Sit down beside me, the green fields are bleeding. Sing me the music of healing. Sing me a song of a lover returning. The darker the night, the nearer the morning. Bring me the news of a new day that's dawning. Sing me the music of healing. Truth's like a hare in the cornfield. You know that it's there, but you can't put your arms round it. All we can hope for is to follow its footprints. Sing me the music of healing. And who would have thought I could feel so contented to learn I was wrong after all of my rambles. I've learned to be hard, and I've learned how to tremble. Sing me the music of healing. Ah, the heart's a wonder, stronger than the guns of thunder. Even when we're torn asunder, love will come again. The cycle of vengeance keeps turning, till each other's sorrows and songs we start learning. Peace is the price for those who are daring. Sing me the music of healing. Time is your friend, it cures all your sorrows, but how can I wait for another tomorrow? One step today and a thousand will follow. Sing me the music of healing. Ah, my heart's a wonder, stronger than the guns of thunder. Even when we're torn asunder, love will come again. You sing the chorus with me. Ah, the heart's a wonder. Thank you very much indeed. Well, I'm delighted to introduce you to a beautiful young singer who is just on her way to making a name for herself in music. She comes from a very musical family. Everyone involved in music of any sort will have heard of Beattie McAteer, who came from, whose people come from this area. And this is, I think, a niece, if I'm not mistaken. That's right, Madge. A grandniece, yes. And you've all heard of Declan McAteer. Declan's daughter. She's a lovely girl and a beautiful singer. Please welcome Stephanie McAteer.
The first song we'll sing for tonight is an Irish song, and I learned it in Manifest. Many years have passed since the
Such a beautiful singer in our midst here tonight. Give her an all big round of applause. We're going to ask that other lovely young performer to come back out onto the stage. I did mention earlier on, of course, she's got a lot of connections with here. Her uncle, Pete Keenan, often performed on the stage here in various plays. Please welcome back Kathleen from Daryl Anke, Kathleen Keenan.
Okay, I'm going to play a Scottish piece now, which was composed by a Scottish harp player, Katrina McKay, and it was called The Swan, and I think she wrote it after an experience she had on a trawl ship, which is also called The Swan.
Thank you.
what after my brother Dino died, Eugene, and I write about him in the book, I won't read that tonight, it's a little bit sad, but we didn't want to play music anymore, and we all went doing different things for a while, and Colm, he joined the Lyric Theatre, and I remember going to see him there, and Liam Neeson had just started in the Lyric Theatre at the same time. Colm was playing bouzouki, and Liam was singing a song called The Rights of Man in that play. But I went to work with Downtown, that's about 28 years ago now, and one of the first programs I did, I decided to try to, well, I'll read a bit about it here, if you can see it. It had been a bad year. By Christmas of 1978, 81 people had been killed. The communities were growing further apart, and many of the leaders in the North were not in the mood to meet or talk. Does that sound familiar? The polarization in Northern society was being amplified by political words and military deeds. I thought it might be a good idea, therefore, to invite the leaders of Northern Ireland's main churches and political groupings to have a bit of a hooly, a Christmas country ceilidh. This ceilidh would attempt to gather together some people who were not in the habit of spending time with each other. I would soon learn that some of these Christians didn't particularly want to be seen too close to each other, Christmas or no Christmas. Many told me that there was no mission of getting them together to sing, play music or tell jokes. I spoke to Eamon Malley and Peter Russell, Morris Hawkins in the newsroom. They agreed the idea was a good one and gave me some telephone numbers. Paisley would be most difficult, I was told. His pulpit-pounding fundamentalism didn't make him an obvious suspect for merriment and frivolity, particularly in the company of political papists and socialist sinners. Nevertheless, he was a must-have. Love him or loathe him, his face on television at the time demanded instant attention, and his voice on the radio was compulsive listening. He would have to be there. They would all have to be there if this was going to work. My first visit was to a socialist sinner called Paddy Devlin. I knew Paddy of old. He was the most socialist part of the Social Democratic and Labour Party. Good friend and a good singer too. He threw back his head and sang a song, then threw back a vodka and sang another. Paddy's two songs, Joe Hill and Sunday Morning Sidewalk, reflected his working class politics and his sympathy with the disadvantaged. Where are you going to next, he asked, chuckling at the idea of the programme. Where does the Reverend Ian Paisley live, I asked in reply. For a start, said Paddy, I don't call him Reverend anything. I call him Ian Paisley, and I don't call people Doctor this or Lord that or Major me arse. They're all just people to me, and they can stick their titles and their privileges for the monkey putty's nuts. And that goes to the Pope and the Queen and the whole lot of them. By the way, would you like a drink or a bite to eat before you go? Paddy gave me directions, and soon I was on my way up the Newton Arts Road, regretting I hadn't taken up his offer to eat, for I realised now I was starving, and I didn't want to meet. I called into a Chinese carryout near the North Road and ate my meal in the car, wondering what manner of man was awaiting me. I drove on to Paisley's house. I was as ready as I ever would be to meet the leader of the Free Presbyterian Church. A pair of boots stuck out from beneath a parked car on a street. Hello, I said. A young man slid out with oil in his hands. Is this Ian Paisley's house? I asked. I am Ian Paisley, came the reply. He looked no more than a boy. I suspect it's my father, though, you want to see, he said. I don't think he's home yet, but you can knock on the door. My mother's there. The recognisable figure of Eileen Paisley assured me with a smile that I was welcome and asked me to wait for her husband in the sitting room. Her daughter, Rhonda, sat with me. David Dunseith was talking to politicians on the television. Does your father sing? I asked. I only heard him sing once, she said. And I laughed so much I couldn't stop. She began to laugh again at the thought of it. Then it seemed as if the house began to shake. He's coming, said Eileen, putting her head round the door. I heard footsteps getting closer, and I shivered slightly, hoping it wouldn't show. The footsteps grew louder, and the house seemed to shake more. Then standing at the door was one of the biggest men I have ever seen. He had large head, large ears, large eyes, large nose, large mouth, large body, large everything. He seemed to fill the whole doorway. As a Catholic child, I had nervously watched the television screen as he controlled thousands with a single roar. Now he was standing right in front of me, fierce as a giant. I explained why I'd come. I was including various leaders in a special Christmas program. I didn't want them to talk about religion or politics, but to sing a song or tell a yarn instead. Slowly I held my microphone up to the mouth of the Reverend Doctor. "How do you prefer to be addressed, by the way?" I asked, trying to break the ice lightly. "Do you want me to call you Reverend or Doctor or Ian?"
"You can call me anything you like, providing you don't call me early in the morning," he replied with a loud laugh. "Are you getting fit to play the mouth organ?" he asked quickly, referring to Jerry Fitt, his arch-rival and current leader of the SDLP. "I don't know how good he is, but the more he plays in my constituency, the more the people vote for me."
"What about a song or a story from yourself?" I said. He put his head in his hands and began to think.
"As you know," he said at last, "I'm an unreformed jailbird. And the first time I went to prison, the prison doctor examined me from head to toe and he said, 'You're fit.' And I said, 'No, I'm Paisley.' Then one day, a prisoner swallowed a half crown hoping he might be let out early and some smart fella says, 'Send for Paisley, he's a doctor, he'll get the coin out.' 'No,' came the reply, 'he's a doctor of theology, not a medical doctor.' 'Well,' says your man, 'Dr. Paisley is able to get money out of a stone, so I'm sure he'll be able to get a half crown out of this man's stomach.'"
The big man was getting into his stride now.
"There was a Jewish rabbi and a Roman Catholic priest sitting in a restaurant one time, and the priest said in a very loud voice, 'Rabbi, when are you going to become liberal and eat the flesh of the pig?'
'At your wedding,' replied the rabbi."
This was a Paisley I had never envisaged, relaxed and radiant with boyish devilment and humour. I was so surprised I could hardly laugh myself, but he laughed enough for both of us. He regaled me with joke after joke, gradually drawing me into a web of companionship. He was magnetic. No wonder he has thousands of disciples, I thought. The man was powerful, like a schoolmaster who cared for his pupils by first scaring them. He portrayed a rare mixture of charisma and awfulness. You were inclined to laugh at the joke before he got to the punchline. "I'm going to Armagh next," I told him, "to see the two archbishops. I hear talk that Archbishop O'Fee will be made a cardinal and the Pope's chair is vacant. Do you think you might go for the job?" I ventured with a smile. Paisley stopped in mid-laugh.
"I might run for Europe," he said, "but I don't think I'd be running for that particular office."
Then he laughed again and wished me well on my travels. I walked away from the door with a well-filled tape and a well-shook hand and began to consider the real contribution this man was capable of making. Archbishop Sims, head of the Anglican Church, opened his door at 11 the following morning and I gazed upon a gentle, unassuming and highly cultured man. "Come in," he said in a plummy English accent. I was offered tea in a delicate porcelain cup. He had remembered my phone call, but with a shy smile he told me of another call he had received just afterwards. "It is one of my ministers, actually," said Dr. Sims, but he didn't realise it was I who answered the phone.
"Is his nibs in?" asked a junior clergyman,
rather gruffly.
"I'm afraid," I said, "this is his nibs."
The poor man, of course, was very embarrassed, but I couldn't help having a little laugh to myself. It's so important to have a laugh sometimes. I liked this man. Despite his apparent aristocratic affectations, I felt very relaxed in his company. An authority on the Book of Kells and medieval Irish literature, he delicately fingered through some old papers to find the poem he wanted to contribute. "When the monks were working on those heavenly intricate letterings," he said, "one wrote a little poem, perhaps by way of recreation, on the margins of a page, and it has been preserved in the old manuscripts to this day. It was inspired by his little white cat, Pangor Ban. I and Pangor Ban, my cat, dislike it. 'Tis a light task we are at. Hunting mice is his delight. Hunting words I sit all night. Practice every day has made Pangor perfect in his trade. I get wisdom day and night, turning darkness into light." He read this little poem with the respect due to Shakespeare. "We have all got our little tasks," he said with a smile, "haven't we? And speaking of such tasks, I don't want you to leave Armagh without roping in the other archbishop. He's a wonderful singer, you know." We stood at the door and viewed the heavenly reachings of both cathedrals, built on sites where, it is said, the sun and moon were once worshipped.
I'm not sure which is highest, he remarked, but I do know the point in the same direction. I bid him goodbye and headed in the direction of the Catholic spire. I had met Archbishop O'Fee twice before, and so on, but I'll just go on to... he arrived. What sort of character is Paisley? Asked the Cardinal with a mischievous smile. What did he do for you? Total jokes, I said. Isn't it good to laugh at the seriousness of it all sometimes? He leaned towards me. You hear the one, he said, about the young priest hearing confessions for the first time, and this man walked in and confessed, bless me, Father, for I have sinned, and I have been making putching. The priest gave him absolution, but wasn't too sure of how much penance to give him, as there was no mention of putching in the canon law books. Hold on a moment, he said to the penitent, and nipped into the other confessional where the old parish priest was hearing, and whispered, there's a man in here making putching, how much will he give him? The old priest thought with a while and then said, if I was you, I'd give him no more than a half a crown of butter. He sat back and chuckled. What about yourself, he said, would you like a sup or something? I declined his offer just as the phone rang and Mamie, his housekeeper, came in. Another explosion, your lordship, she said, two killed, I'm afraid. The Archbishop excused himself and I heard him give a statement to the press. He returned with a face sad and pained. I need a little while, he said. Mamie will bring you a cup of tea. You'll have to excuse me for a few moments. So, that's all. I go on to talk about the various other people that they met up with. But the reason why I did was that I sometimes think that the media, the politicians often use the media to show how different they are. And they're really not different at all. Pretend to be different. So I want to use the media to show that they weren't different. Afterwards, I taped them all, but I put Paisley laughing at the Cardinal's jokes. He didn't like that. And he rang me up and he says, you doctored the tapes, friend. And I said, I edited the tapes, doctor. And he said, you doctored the tapes, editor. But anyway, there's another little bit here. When we went to the States, we played in Carnegie Hall, and before we left home, our mother said, whatever you do, New York's a very dangerous place. Don't leave each other, stay together. And I was the eldest, there were five of us. And we were staying in a hotel on 44th Street, and the taxi came, and there were five of us in a double bass. And the taxi man says, I can't take you all. You have to get two taxis. I said, no, we're not separating. You have to take us all. He said, well, you're not coming on my taxi, the five of you. So we decided to walk. And we had to walk several streets, and we get lost several times. And it's God's truth. We were asking people how to get to Carnegie Hall, and we get all these smart-ass New York answers like, get a good agent, or practice, and all the rest. But in Boston, we met up with a lot of Protestant and Catholic people, of course, nationalists and unionists or whatever, but they all had met up over there. And I'll just read this a little bit because I think it's a little bit relevant. You're not fed up with reading?
No.
No, you sure? We also went to Canada. We decided to give our brother Hugh a surprise. He is in Ottawa at the time. We didn't know what he was at. We decided to give him a surprise by appearing, and we were appearing on a talk show on television in Ottawa. And we arrived, and Hugh picked us up at the airport, and we said, what sort of a man will be doing the interview? And he said, he's all right. Don't worry about him too much. But when the lights went on, who was presenting the program but Hugh, my brother? And he started to ask us the most difficult questions ever we were asked. But we played in a place called the Harp and Bard, and in Boston. It's sort of a nightclub, and rich people would come in and have a meal and riff quietly while we were playing. But we came across, after the concert was over, sitting down having a little drink, met these two men.
Neither had been to Ireland before, but they were Irish. One said that his folks had come over with a potato famine. Mine were here before that, said the second. It was Jack Murphy and Sam Maharg from the two sides of yesterday, now Boston business partners and drinking together like they knew no difference. In a funny way, it is mindful of the farm at home where my father, in bringing together the warring piglets of different litters, would sprinkle their tails on the walls of their common sty with large handfuls of jay's fluid. They'll never know who they are now. The scent of time, space, money and whiskey had dulled all divisions between Jack and Sam, and with their wives, Kate and Rebecca, they were celebrating their commonality. You betcha, said Jack Murphy. Have you ever heard of South Armagh? Border country, I believe. That's my country. I know it well, I said. No flies in them bites. You betcha, said Jack Murphy. They've got to live by their wits, that's why. There's nothing but rocks. Good rebel IRA country, I believe, he added with a chuckle, at the head of the column. A land of poets, I said, McCooey and O'Dornian, and a land of rebels too long before there was an IRA. It's in the gap of the north, no man's land. Sounds like the debatable land, said Sam Maharg suddenly. Sounds interesting, I said. Glasses were refilled and Sam Maharg closed his eyes as if looking for something in the dark. Having found it, he seemed satisfied and took a long, sucking swig of scotch. My people, I gather, came from the borderland between England and Scotland, he began. The debatable lands. Have you heard of the Reavers? Welcoming our silence as a signal to proceed, he sat up in his chair and brought us back to the turning of the 14th century and the stirrings of the people who in time would number in Ireland as Ulster Scots and in America as Scots-Irish. In fact, you could go back further than that, he said, to the Roman general Hadrian, who built a wall to keep them out. When Robert the Bruce gained independence for Scotland, these people belonged to neither England nor Scotland, and the only allegiance they had was to their own clan chiefs. Reaver means plunderer, he said, and no wonder, as they were well plundered themselves and trampled upon when the Scots and English went into battle with each other. They learned their trade well and became the greatest char of cutthroats and gangsters that ever inhabited the island of Britain, he said. Their main contribution to English culture were the words blackmail, which was protection money paid to them rather than greenmail, which is paid to the landowner, and bereaved, which was what you become when your loved one was killed by a reaver. There was little loss, love lost between the Archbishop of Glasgow, Gavin Dunbar, and the Reavers. In fact, in 1528, he put a curse on them that would make the hair stand on the head of the bald. By the authority of Almighty God, the Father of Heaven, His Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ, and of the Holy Ghost, I curse their head and all the hairs in their head. I curse their face, their hand, their mouth, their knees, their tongue, their teeth, their crag, whatever that is, their shoulders, their breast, their heart, their stomach, their bake, their warm, their the top of their head, the sole of their feet, before and behind, within and without. And finally, I condemn them perpetually to the deep pit of hell to remain with Lucifer and his fellows. This is a direct quotation. The main season for skullduggery lay between Lammas time of August and the reopening of the courts. There was a three-month period when judges were nowhere to be seen, and they kidnapped cattle and sheep, and which were healthy enough to be coaxed at a high speed over solid ground from one clan to the other. Between rustling, the time for a football match, and one such match documented in 1599 between the Armstrongs from the Scottish side and the Ridleys from the English turned out to be a bit on the rough side. Three Ridleys got killed, 30 taken prisoner, and many were badly injured, including one John Wyfield, whose injuries were such that his bowels came out, but they're sewed up again. This is all well documented. These clans were such a thorn in the side of both England and Scotland that when the chance of land came up in Ulster after the flight of the Earls in 1607, many of the Reavers were deported or cajoled into emigrating there. Famous Reaver names that had Viking, Norman, Anglo-Saxon and Pictish origins were Armstrong, Graham, Kerr, Johnson, Nixon, Scott, Foster, Hume and Trimble. Thank you.
The English were always very generous about making gifts of land which belonged to someone else, cut in Jack Murphy. What about your own name, Sam, I asked. You haven't mentioned Maharg. It sounds strange, he said, but it's what I've always been told. Our name was Graham, but we were hunted and haunted so much that we reversed the letters and the name became Maharg. I won't tell, I said. Would that turn the curse into a blessing? Asked Jack Murphy with a tongue in his cheek. I doubt it, said Maharg. We're a stubborn bunch. We survived, went to Ulster, and when it came to taming a frontier, there was none better than we, be it in England, Ireland, or later America. I readied myself for a song of the Reavers in return for his story. But before I did, Rebecca cut in the silence. If we survived, she said, it is not because of our stubbornness, but rather in spite of it. She then quietly began to sing another song from that period, but one of great tenderness. It is called The Lament for the Border Widow. When people are savaged, they become savages, said Maharg. Isn't that right, Jack Murphy? At least our cutthroats were more humane than your cutthroats, said Murphy. We were cursed too, you know, he said, by Maha, the woman who is forced to race against the horses of the King of Ulster and give her name to the city of Armagh. Did you know that? Is it any wonder that we are the way we are? There's a curse in both our houses. I believe they're knocking hell out of each other in the old country these days, said Maharg. Killing each other to get at each other, said Murphy. They drank a toast to friendship, smiled, and then put their arms round each other like dancers about to swing in a four-hand reel. People of all nationalities frequented the Harp and Bard, English, German, Jew and Palestinian, all wanting to be Irish for the night. The old 78 RPM record by the Flanagan brothers, which I had heard in Bern many years ago, began to make sense. Let ye all be Irish tonight, let ye all be Irish tonight. Your French, Scotch and Germans, Italians and Jews, act like McKenna's, O'Shea's and O'Toole's, and I'll shake you all by the hand, as if you come from Ireland. Forget all your troubles, your cares and your woes. Imagine you're one of the mechs of the O's. Do everything Irish except start a fight. Let you all be Irish tonight. So let you all be Irish tonight. Thanks. I'll sing you a song. I know you're all great singers, so I can see it in your eyes. It's a song about a man who used to play in goals, not Kevin Fagan. This man was a bad goalkeeper. In fact, the first game he played in, he let in something like 7 goals in the first half. And he could catch nothing. The ball was going between his legs and between under his oxter. And at halftime, he was so depressed that he put his head in his hands and missed. In the second half, it was even worse. He was suicidal, threw himself in front of a bus, and the bus went under him. I don't know if it's true or not. But to make matters worse, his name is Dunn. I once was well acquainted with a man called John Joseph Alexander Big Francis Red-Headed Dunn. A very civil, simple, unsophisticated sort of a man, and fond of harmless fun. He courted young and married wives when he was 21, and a very respectable family had Mr. and Mrs. Dunn. For there was high Dunn, low Dunn, under Dunn and over Dunn. All the other younger Dunns in and out they run. There was old Dunn and young Dunn, and young Dunn's youngest son. Young Dunn will be a Dunn when all Dunn's done, that's a course. Well, in course of time, this Joseph Dunn, he found himself a wife, but soon he found he had to fight the hardest fight of life, for to keep 10 little bellies full, and a wife that wanted fun, and anyone could do all that, you want to say, well done. For there was high Dunn, low Dunn, under Dunn and over Dunn, all the other younger Dunns in and out they run. There was old Dunn and young Dunn, and young Dunn's youngest son. Young Dunn will be a Dunn when all Dunn's done. Don't strain yourselves in the chorus, for God's sake. Well, when Mrs. Dunn presented Dunn with their first bouncing, bouncing, dangerously bouncing son, they named him Henry Alexander Big John Francis Red-Headed Dunn after his father.
but eventually called him Cherry Plum for short. And when the slice pad loafened up, and children more did come, said Mrs. Dunn, then Mr. Dunn, more bread or we'll be done. For there was High Dunn, Under Dunn, and all the other younger Dunns, in and out they run. There was Old Dunn, and Young Dunn's youngest son. Young Dunn will be a Dunn, when Old Dunn's done. That's great altogether. Harmonies and rhythm been flung at me now. Last verse, same song. Well, here's to the youngest son of Dunn, likewise to the oldest Dunn. And here's to the youngest son of Dunn, when the oldest Dunn is done. For anyone could be well done in this big wicked world. What's done by Dunn must be well done. So well done, good old Dunn. For there was High Dunn, Under Dunn, and all the other younger Dunns, in and out they run. There was Old Dunn, and Young Dunn's youngest son. Young Dunn will be a Dunn when Old Dunn's done. Try it on your own this time to test your head for sobriety and diction and tightness of the upper row. Are you ready? For there was High Dunn, all the other younger Dunns, in and out they run. There was Old Dunn, and Young Dunn's youngest son. Young Dunn will be a Dunn when Old Dunn's done. Thank you very much. I don't know how we're fixed for time, Francie or PJ. Do you have to go home early? It's probably way past your bedtime. We'll do another two. Is that all right? Yeah. Sing a song. I read a little bit about it in the book as well. I was playing in a place called St. Louis, Missouri one time, and this blonde woman came up to me and she says, would you like to come to Reno with me? And I said, that's an interesting invitation. What had you in mind? And it turned out her name was Jill Berryman, and she was the director of the Sierra Arts Foundation in Reno, Nevada. And she felt that my songs coming from a background of conflict, in many cases, might have some impact or meaning to the gangland prisoners in Reno. And I went in there, and I discovered that they had incredible stories to tell themselves. And I thought if they could write a song about their life, it would make a wonderful song. And I was lucky enough to meet up with a judge, a woman called Frances Doherty, whose father came from Belfast. Father came from Donegal, mother came from Belfast. And I said, if you can get the prisoners to write a song about their own life, will you accept it as a plea in their defence? And eventually she said she would. And I went into the prison the next day, and even though I've been writing songs for years, I never knew how to teach anyone how to write a song. But it's amazing what the mixture of terror and adrenaline can create when you're standing in front of 80 or 90 young prisoners. But they were very good, they helped me. And we come up with a simple solution. There'd be three verses in the song. The first verse would be about the past, the middle verse about the present, and the third verse about the future. But we had to get some air that everybody knew to put the words to. And I thought, who's popular in America? Maybe Elvis Presley. But most of them hadn't heard of Elvis Presley, which gave me some hope. Well, no, he was a good fella in his own way. But the only melody they all knew in common was Twinkle, Twinkle, Little Star. And it nearly brought a tear to my eye because their culture life had ended very young. But there was a big black lad from Detroit with a knife marked down his face. He says, listen, Baba, I ain't gonna sing no Twinkle, Twinkle, Little Star. No judge. And I says, well, do you know the air of Kumbaya? He says, yeah, bro, that's a good song. I said, well, it's the same air as Twinkle, Twinkle, Little Star, which it is. Of course, that melody is known in every folk culture in the world. And the kids from down around the Caribbean, they knew the melody but a different rhythm to it. And they went da 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 da
So they all got into writing. And there was one thing I said, before you finish the song, you're going to have some hope in it, or else the judge would be worried about you. And if you don't have any vision for the future, create one and repeat it like a mantra until it becomes part of you anyway. And I said, what do you mean hope? There's no hope. There's only despair. I thought, well, if you keep complaining all the time, or if you keep nyamming, I didn't say that, I wouldn't have understood that. But if you keep complaining, people stop listening to you. And I thought about this story I heard about an old man who used to sit down in the pier in Restrever and smoke his pipe. And one year, a tourist came to Northern Ireland. When was it, let me see? 1995. No, it's great to see people coming from abroad. But this man, what happened to him, but he fell right into the water. And he starts to shout, listen, you so-and-so, I can't swim. Little man. So you might come up for the second time and there's salt water coming out of his ears. Listen, you bing, I can't swim. Little man. So you might come up for the third time and the fish coming down his nose. Just listen, you hing, I can't swim. The old man took the pipe out of his mouth and he says, I can't swim either, but I don't keep shouting about it. They like that. But anyway, I'm going to sing you one song that is written by a young girl who is not prison. And I'll always remember, she had long fair hair in her head and she had chains in her ankles. Her name is Danielle McCauley. I was born in Stanford on the bay. It seems so long now, so far away. There were pretty flowers all around. They grew up, but I grew down. Will you hear me? Will you hear me? When I was only very young, my dad left home before my life begun. He only wanted patient drugs. My mama cried and she gave me hugs. Will you hear me? Will you hear me? My youngest brother, he got killed right beside our favorite hill. They came and took my dad away and I locked him up in Reno jail. When I was 8, we moved to Dayton. That's where I learned that word called hatin'. When I was 10, I ran away. My man grandma cried all day. Sold my body to buy my food. I was beaten, bullied, and abused. Will you help me turn the page? I'm a girl of 17 years of age. I'll finish off with this one. Well, except this unbridled enthusiasm for an encore, I might do another one. But I'd be gauging the enthusiasm. We've done a fair amount of serious songs. We often talk about the youth of today. Bad crowd. We were 10 times worse. I know, certainly, very few people drink and drive these days. In the old days, people would hardly get into the car except for a full. I remember my father coming down the Ryan Road. He says, I had to keep one eye closed the whole way coming down that road. As soon as I opened the second eye, I could see two roads. It was sort of normal in those days. People don't do it now, thank God. But
This is a song about a man who is going home from a night out one night. He had too many drinks on him. And he came flying down the road, taking the two sides of the road, and he saw a fish and chip van, and he screamed to a halt behind the fish and chip van, "Hey, give us two fish suppers and plenty of vinegar, please." But it wasn't a fish and chip van. A breathalyzer. "I'll give you your breakfast as well, you boy." As I was slowly driving from Gorman's pub one night, a police car pulled in front of me, giving me an awful bloody fright. Two constables approached me. They said, "We think you're fun." I looked from one to the other, only one actually, and then said, "To you, not a good idea. Oh, how many whiskeys did you have tonight? How many did you consume?" The answer, my friend, is blown in the wind. You'll know it when you blow up this balloon. Well, they brought me to the station. That's where the fun begun. They handed me a few balloons, and I burst them one by one. They handed me a bottle, I leaned against the wall. I did my best to please them and floated out the hall. Then the sergeant, he'd roar, "Hallelujah!" Then he made me dry the floor, "Hallelujah!" But since that sad occasion, actually this always reminds me of a friend of mine who remained nameless. But one Lent, his wife said, "You'd be going off drink for Lent, wouldn't you?" She had a hatchet in her hand at the time. So it's funny enough, I was thinking about that. That's a bit of a tension. So see, I and the hatchet. But all during Ash Wednesday, it was very difficult. When he came back Ash Wednesday night, it was more or less impossible. And he'd out for just the one. But of course, he met up with all sorts of ramscullions and rogues. And about 3 o'clock in the morning, heads home. Looks up the stairs, suddenly he remembers his wife's in bed with a hatchet under her chin, as he about to not wake her up. And he visualizes his obituary column in both the Irish News and the Newsletter. He's a very broad-minded sort of a man. He's just about to not wake her up. He took off his boots at the bottom of the stairs. Then he says, "Stockings cause quite a thistle." Which they do, actually. Pulled off the socks as well. Asks he, "To hell with it, I'll give her a surprise." Off come the top coat, the half coat, trousers, underpants, vest, scapulars, a lot. And another thing that had been around his waist for years, nobody seemed to know what it was for. Up the stairs he goes, totally drunk and totally naked with the clothes over his arm. And it's only when he got to the top of the stairs he discovered he was on a bus. But since that sad occasion, I haven't touched a drop. I've tried some Coca-Cola and Lucozid and paper crisps, some Monkey Nuts and Peanuts and Fisherman's Friends, and found that not much cop. I've tried going out with women, and that's not bad, it's true. But I've come to this conclusion, and I'll sing it now for you. I'm going back on the booze tomorrow, the booze tomorrow, the booze tomorrow. I'm going back on the booze tomorrow, I'm gonna drink all day, I'm going on the booze, booze, booze. How about use, 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 use and come to. We're going on the booze, booze, sing it for the crack. I'm going back on the booze tomorrow, the booze tomorrow, the booze tomorrow. I'm going back on the booze tomorrow, I'm gonna drink all day, I'm going on the booze, booze, booze. How about booze, easy come to. We're going on the booze, booze, booze.
Thank you, Tommy. That was absolutely wonderful. I think tonight, the old saying, a prophet is never a prophet in his homeland, has been stood completely on his head. Because, I say, no matter how often Tommy Sands will come back to this area, I think the house will still be full and we all still enjoy him. Townlands. We'll hear from Tommy tonight from the townland of Ryan to the cities of Europe. But tonight, in our own little townlands, we've had some talent on show tonight from about a 5 mile square radius of here. I think the talent tonight has been world class, and I think will be world class in the future for the people who have entertained. We had the wonderful sounds of Kathy Keenan on the harp. Kathy has a pure saintly sounds on the harp. I think she has a fantastic future ahead of her. We moved on to the Sheila Neiman Rooney, the Rooney family again from the Bourne area. We had Marvis in the team, a fantastic young group of people when they're all together. And the two of them tonight gave a fantastic performance. But just the two of them, I think it was wonderful as well. We moved on, I'm not going to be biased in this one, to my daughter Stephanie, who I was very, very proud of tonight as well. They enjoyed themselves and we enjoyed listening even more. But tonight's, just for information, tonight's takings at the door was in aid of the Busy Bees playgroup. So in the true sort of socialist, I suppose, spirit of Jim Larkin, we decided tonight that we would do something community based. So you've helped the community as well as helping the whole weekend by donating tonight's takings to the Busy Bee community group. So we would ask Christine Halpany, who's the chairperson, actually, to make a special presentation to Tommy as a token of his entertainment tonight and in memory of the first inaugural Jim Larkin Autumn School. So Christine is coming up.
Thank you very much, Declan, and many thanks for that beautiful painting of Warren Point. It's beautiful. Before I sing it, I'd just like to say once again how delighted I am to be here. It's Byrne and its environs is also very important to me. Fire the jugglers is my face. Sorry for that, Francie. But and to look around the audience and see people that I've known for many, many years. Yeah, that's a good idea. And I'd also like to congratulate PJ Bradley and the committee for beginning this event to a man, a Byrne man, who's been so important in the world. I'm going to finish with this one, and it's a song with the River Lagan, which runs through Belfast. So that's just attached to my underpants, Francis. Where was I? Yeah. song goes, when we dance, we'll dance together. When we cry, we'll hold each other. When we love forever, down by the Lagan side. I wrote a song for the opening of a hall of the Waterford Hall of Belfast. And I'd like to leave you with this tonight. And many, many thanks once again. Thank you very much. I thought she was a vision. She stopped me with her smile. Down by the river, we walked along in style. She said, you're welcome back again, and won't you stay a while? Down by the Lagan side, this is a chorus. And when we dance, we'll dance together. When we cry, we'll hold each other. And when we love, we'll love forever. Down by the Lagan side. From Trelleford. So full of joy and pain that the pipers and the harpers and the lambeck drummers play. She said, who owns the teardrops falling in the rain? Down by the Lagan side. When we dance, and when we dance. Side by side, and the bells of Belfast City sang harmony and pride. The past it has been taken, but the future's yours and mine. Down by the Lagan side. And when because the place is full of great singers. When we dance together. When we dance, we'll dance together. When we cry.
Thank you.